George Njuguna, and I don't think you heard me the first time I talked, because I just realized my master was down there. And apologies for that, but today I have, I'll call him a friend. was it COVID? I think it was COVID that brought us together. Slightly the year before. No, it was COVID. It was the year of COVID. It was COVID came in 2019. Yeah. And we've become friends since then. He started something called the Paul's Ark. We all know what the Ark was all about, and probably he has a story behind it. With me is, we call him Uncle Paul. How are you, sir?
I'm well, thank you, George. Nice to be here.
Nice to be here?
Yes.
You look so relaxed. No, no collar.
Hey, so that's how we run out in the streets.
Yes.
Yes,
that is how the streets, how we are supposed to be out there in the streets.
Yes.
Who is Uncle Paul, for those who may not know who you are?
All right, so Uncle Paul is many things to many people. Mm-hmm. Uncle Paul is a son. Uncle Paul is a husband. Mm-hmm. Uncle Paul is a father. Mm-hmm. So I'm married to Shiko for the last 17 years. Mm-hmm. We have got three children, mm-hmm. Three biological children. Mm-hmm. Mashira, who is 15, Wangari, who is 13, Mungi, mm-hmm. who is turning 11, mm-hmm. in a couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. So I'm the son to the late Colonel Peter Mashira, mm-hmm. and Rachel Wangari, his wife, mm-hmm. and the son-in-law to James Mwangi and Sarah Ngina. Mm-hmm. Uncle Paul is also a brother. Mm-hmm. I've got four siblings. Mm-hmm. And Uncle Paul is also an uncle to many, many, many children. So Uncle Paul is also an Anglican clergy.
Yes.
Ordained with the Anglican Church in Kenya. Mm-hmm. Serving under the leadership of the Archbishop, the Right Reverend, the Most Reverend Jackson Elizabeth, mm-hmm. at the All Saints Cathedral Diocese. Mm-hmm. And I'm also the founder of an organization called the Uncle Paul's Ark. Mm-hmm. So that is who I am.
That is who you are.
Uncle Paul is a Sunday school teacher. Mm-hmm. So whenever you think of Uncle Paul, think about his family, mm-hmm. think about the church, think about ministry to children. Mm-hmm. That's the area that makes Uncle Paul resonate.
Very, very well.
Yes.
Let's begin. Let me begin by you being made a clergy. How did that come? Is it something you just woke up and said, this is what I'm going to do, or were you doing something else before?
So I'm a clergy. Let me say this. I'm the son of a clergy. Mm-hmm. And what happened is, mm-hmm. since
don't summarize it.
I don't summarize it.
Yes.
So my dad, mm-hmm. my dad was a brilliant, brilliant preacher, mm-hmm. and a lovely man. Mm-hmm. What you saw is what you got. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that I really enjoyed about Dad, mm-hmm. was his ability to communicate the gospel, mm-hmm. in a very simple way, mm-hmm. and also in a very hilarious manner. Mm-hmm. So he had a way of pronouncing profound truths, mm-hmm. but then in a manner that anyone could understand. Mm-hmm. So the only problem I had with Dad was that he never came to Sunday school. Mm-hmm. You see, being
why?
Being his son, mm-hmm. I basically then grew in his parish, mm-hmm. he was an Anglican clergy.
Yes.
And as a vicar or as a senior pastor, mm-hmm. senior pastors rarely, if ever, mm-hmm. go to Sunday school.
Yeah.
So Dad was largely in the main service, mm-hmm. and never got to come to Sunday school where we were. Mm-hmm. And when we were in Sunday school, we would hear people burst out in laughter, having a really nice time under the ministry, under the ministry of my dad.
Mm.
And so the big beef at home used to be, why don't you come
and teach
to Sunday school?
Yeah, to make us laugh.
To make us laugh, yeah. Also.
Mm.
You know, just, you know, let's have this thing that is going out in the main service, also out in the Sunday school. And so I grew up desiring to be the guy who plays dad in Sunday school.
Ah.
So let him continue doing his thing among the older guys. And make sure that kids coming to church in Sunday school will have a good laugh. So we could almost say that maybe my desire to do Sunday school was largely informed by my desire to make kids laugh in church. Very wrong motive.
You thought it was a wrong motive, but God had...
But God had his...
Yeah.
So many conversations would happen at home,
mm-hmm.
and I would basically be telling dad, hey, listen, you never come to Sunday school, but more so, I have a... My observation is that you really... The church is really about adult church.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever you guys are thinking of the development of the church,
mm-hmm.
you're largely thinking about yourselves.
Mm-hmm.
When you're thinking about putting up audiovisual screens
mm-hmm.
in church, you're thinking about the adult church.
Yeah.
How is it that back in the day, the Anglican church, most Anglican churches used to have a piano
yes.
in the main sanctuary.
Yes.
So nowadays it's a whole disco in there.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a whole drum set, there's a keyboard.
Which is a good thing.
Which is a good thing. It's a great improvement.
Yeah.
I mean, it has really nurtured and really grown.
And hymns used to be, the numbers of the hymns
used to be higher.
Some churches still do have.
Churches still do have. So, and my argument would be, why don't we move the piano
mm-hmm.
from the main service
mm-hmm.
to Sunday school?
Mm.
I mean, what is it about the main church that you guys think that it's okay for you to have a piano and us guys in Sunday school don't have a piano?
Yeah.
So, and there'll be many of those things, many of those conversations. Why is it that when you go to Sunday school, usually we'd have to be the ones arranging our seats and sometimes even having to be the ones wiping them.
Yeah.
But you guys, there is a guy who comes on Saturday, the Vajra, who basically sweeps up the place, washes it and cleans it up. I mean, why is it that in Sunday school, we're almost like an afterthought? So dad would listen to me, and I remember one time him said, you know, why don't you become a clergy? Then I'm like,
how old were you?
I could have been in high school.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, because you see now in high school is where now your adolescent hormones are all over the place. And you actually think your dad doesn't know much. So, and you need to teach your dad one or two things. So, yeah, and he says, you know, let me tell you, why don't you consider being a clergy? Because all these things that you keep on suggesting, maybe it's a high time that you actually go to the table of leadership and start having these decisions, start influencing these decisions. In fact, his first invitation was for me to join the parish council, not even to become... not even to become a clergy.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to sit in the parish council because the parish council comprised of old men and women. I mean, so what was I going to tell them? I mean, I didn't want anything to do that. But then dad spotted that I had a passion for the things of God. And he really encouraged me to be a clergy, but I didn't want to be a clergy. Why? Because, I mean, I wanted to be a rich man. I mean, I wanted to do stuff. I wanted to make money to support clergy. I didn't want to be a clergy, my friend. Because back in the day, maybe even today, Anglican clergy are not paid much. So it was not glamorous. It was not prestigious to be. It was not prestigious to be a clergy. So anyway, I didn't want to be a clergy, and I didn't want anything to do with that. And so, dad would keep on telling me, the calling of God is upon your life. But what I've observed in you is that if you know God is going to get you along Mombasa Road, you will do anything to be on Wayaki if you're heading to Western Kenya. And so I said, okay, listen, I mean, let's see whether Let's see whether he'll catch up with me. Mm-hmm. And for sure he did catch up with me.
He's always right on that road.
He's always on that road.
Yeah.
In the year 2007, mm-hmm. I got involved in a tragic road accident. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I went to college. Mm-hmm. Before then, I went to college, did my first degree, and I got a job.
Mm-hmm. Which was in what?
Which was a Bachelor of Commerce.
Okay.
I didn't want anything to do with the clergy. So I did a Bachelor of Commerce, uh-huh. at the Catholic University. Uh-huh. I graduated and joined the World Vision. Mm-hmm. And I was on my way to serious success. Mm-hmm. I worked in World Vision for 10 years. Mm-hmm. So it was during the 10th year at World Vision that I was traveling from Narok to Nairobi. I was involved in a tragic road accident. Mm-hmm. We were 10 of us in a vehicle, mm-hmm. 6 of us died. 4 of us survived. Mm. The 4 of them, one of them being myself. Mm. And during that time when I was recovering, everything changed. Mm. Completely. Mm. So let me tell you what changed. Mm. I still remember when I boarded that ill-fitted shuttle, mm-hmm. coming from Narok to Nairobi. Mm. When I sat inside that vehicle, there was nothing that suggested that within a couple of minutes, or maybe within less than an hour, we would be involved in a tragic road accident, and most of the guys I was with here were going to be dead. So, when the journey started, I was newly married. I was actually barely 1 year into marriage. I had just gotten married in 2006, November. The accident happened in 2007 September. So it was barely a year into marriage.
Yeah.
And I remember my wife called me, just to know, she knew that I was traveling. So she was asking me, so how far have you gone? And I told her, well, I'm not quite sure. When I figure out where I am, I'll call you back. And I never call her back. So the accident must have happened shortly thereafter. I never got to know about what happened, maybe until 3 days later when I woke up and found myself at the Nairobi hospital. And everything changed because I just discovered that 1 minute you can be here, the next minute you're not.
Yeah.
And it occurred to me that it didn't matter what I had studied at the university. It didn't matter how much money I had
in the bank. Yeah.
It didn't matter what clothes were back on. I mean, within the twinkling of an eye, your life can be no more. So, but one of the people who died was known to me. He was a G4S security officer. But you know, G4S has got this transit facility.
Yes.
I mean, this courier facility.
Yeah.
So this guy used to come to our offices. He would take our documents in Narok and send them over to Nairobi, the head office. So we had left the office around the same time, because I was traveling back to Nairobi on an evening, and so he had just come to our office, collected the correspondence, the notes, the documents that needed, the papers that needed, and he had come with them into the shuttle. He sat right at the back, and I sat right at the front. And so when the accident happened, it was a trailer that was that lost brake on a descent, and it was following us. So its brakes failed, and it came and rammed right behind us, at the back of the, it came and rammed behind the shuttle. And so all the people at the back seats were basically smashed on the spot, died on the spot. And I remember that this man was married and he had children, because we used to talk. So I knew that I was married, but I didn't have children as yet. And I kept on thinking to myself, I mean, logically speaking, it's me who should have died, because now these kids I've been left without a daddy. And I mean, I was so messed up, man. And I just kept on thinking, so what are the chances that 6 out of 10 would die? Why should I be the one to survive? So, you know, the way something happens and you keep on asking the Lord, why me?
Why me?
Usually it is when something bad happens. So in this case, it was something good that has happened. My life has been saved. And the question I kept on asking is, why me? I mean, why me? Why should I be the one alive? And what happened is that everything I once held dear built my life upon. It became nonsense. I didn't care how much money I had or I didn't have. I didn't care. I don't know. All I wanted to do was preach, tell people about God, and not people. I wanted to tell children that there is a Jesus, and this Jesus is for real. And that putting your trust and hope in Him is the best thing that could ever happen. So, around that time, I went back to school and now did a theological course. And it was in the course of doing that theological course that my local parish, St. James Buruburu, then approached me and asked, would you want us to present your case to the bishop for you to be ordained and come and help us with the children ministry? The church already knew that I was very passionate about children ministry. And so when that offer was made, I was like, yeah, sure, why not? That's how I got into the ordained ministry.
Which year was this now?
It was in the year 2013, August.
August, yes.
Okay. Yes.
I want us to pause there. When we come back, we continue with the journey.
All right.
Okay?
All right.